I'm sick, Brian.
What, like emotionally sick?
No, I mean, spirit, I don't know.
You suffer from a malaise? Is that what's going on?
We're all on a spectrum, but yeah, no, I've got. Do you get sick a lot? Is that a thing that happens to you?
I never get sick. I mean, except for all the times that I'm coughing and sneezing and coming home and sleeping in late because I'm not feeling well, but I never get sick. Yeah! I'm certainly not sick of Tuesday nights because that means it has gotta be go time for Night Attack. Bringing you the best of the worst of the internet since 1998. The original founders of the Lemon Party. Hello, beautiful people. It's Brian Brushwood, live in Austin, Texas. Joined, as always, by my BFF over in OAK. It's JRY. What's going on, buddy?
Oh, Brian, I'm ready.
All right, then roll the lullaby. We're out.
This is my new side.
It's I'm ready. Like, never actually doing anything. Just like, I'm ready.
I'm ready to rock steady. Brian, it's a hell of a night. We've got a beautiful sky. Wonderful.
hey, Monty, have you ever seen Lemon Party?
Mikey Neumann, our new best friend is on the show tonight. He's going to give us one of his patented quizzes. We've got so much stuff to share. Ryan, what's up with Carl?
Carl Jung? Are we going to talk philosophy?
Well, I mean, specifically Carl Jung, of course, big philosopher, great guy.
Okay, can we play a game? Called Who Knows Less About Carl Jung? Brian,
well, here's
Justin.
What I do know. He had a son that apparently decided was going to be better to sell hamburgers than it was to continue his father's legacy. Everything Carl Jung gets pissed about that?
No, that's it's really because he's lashing out against his cousin, Carl Weathers, old Action Jackson. He's like, yeah. He thinks he's so strong and tough, and so I'm going to make hamburgers. I'm Carl's Jr. California Carl.
He's got his little alter ego. You always gotta be careful about people with two names.
Yeah.
Like, you know, Carl's Jr.
Yeah.
Until he's creeping on the DL, trying to do some dirt without anybody knowing.
Carl Creeper? What does he do?
He's Hardee's.
Wait, oh, God. Yeah. Wow.
All of a sudden, and like Carl's Jr. is like, hey, I'll tell you what, I'll sell you a good hamburger at a great price. Come on in. I'm Carl's Jr. My father invented psychology. And then Hardee's just like, yeah, no, I got all that.
That was really confusing to me. Like, there would be some cities that had both. Oh, man, if you're an audio listener, you're missing out on the old Rockin' Hardee's thrust.
Rockin' Hardee's hot thrust. You have Hardee's sauce on your face.
We don't have either of those here in Texas. We don't have Carl's Jr. or...
you want to know what? You're not missing anything. I grew up without Carl's Jr. and Hardee's in my life. They are the bottom of the barrel of the food.
Pretty well, weak. Okay, because that's the way I remember it as well. Because I would only see a Hardee's by Cinco Bayou in Fort Walton Beach, Florida, and it was pretty ganky. But yet, so that was when I would go visit my grandparents. But my cousins, when I visited them in San Diego, everything's all beautiful and nice. There was a Carl's Jr. So yeah. It's like it's as though. It's as though the coolest thing I couldn't have got married and became clones with the gankiest thing. Ooh. I couldn't have.
That's actually their number one seller, the Ganky Burger. Well, Ganky Burger is, yeah, it's two all-beef patties and then a sense of regret.
Yeah. You know what? You got to hand it.
They bake it on the bun.
You got to hand it to Carl Jung, though.
What?
Or Carl
Yo,
Jr.
Hey, big shout out to Carl Jung.
Carl Jr. So sorry. So you
hey, everybody, let's get Carl Jung trending right now. Hey, everybody, just say thumbs up Carl Jung on Twitter right now. Go to your Twitter right now. #ThumbsUpCarlYoung.
Live on the line, we've got the ghost of Carl Jung. Carl Jung, you're live. Go.
Yeah, hello.
What's funny is I gave Bonnie the...
Oh, me? Yeah, hey, I had it rough starting out, you know. I made a really You know, I had a big fail. We're all talking about failure now. Fail. Out in the, like, yeah, fail.
And so what was it you failed at, Carl Jung, again?
Well, my first ticket to success, I thought, was the Hot Carl Burger, but it didn't go anywhere.
Well, maybe your son will make that a success.
Oh, he can do whatever he wants. Oh.
Wait, are you a little disappointed in your offspring, Carl Jung, the ghost of Carl Jung?
I think he's done a fine job cleaning up my Hot Carl mess.
All right. Hey, Carl, you ever been to lemonparty.org?
All right. So here, let's get into it. A lot of people were over the moon last week. Oh, dude, he is on it.
He's very disappointed in his burger slinging son.
He is. He's just like, you know, you don't need a mountain of research to tell that father is upset with where his son's life went. So we had a hell of an episode last week. Thank you to everybody. We got great reaction on it. But one of the segments that people really, really liked was Bonnie being revealed to some of the seedier memes of the internet.
Sure. You know, they call it the unholy trilogy. Trinity, take two. Carl, you're on the line. You got Tub Girl, you got your Goatsy, and you got your lemonparty.org. So
here's the deal. What we want Bonnie to do, how would you describe your wife, Brian, when it comes to this kind of stuff? We're denizens of the internet. We've been sending around memes, you know, like this for years and years and years. But why would Bonnie be spared of all that?
Okay, so you and I have that disease that no matter what's on the other end, we can't not click on it. We can't not know what everyone's, you know, two girls, one cup. You never saw two girls, one cup either.
No, that's fine. Okay. Yeah. All right. That's okay.
Let's not blow it all in one episode.
Everybody's talking about it. We got a whole summer.
You know what I find fascinating is that the names are just totally like they should give me more than like they really do, but somehow there's still just these little vague.
It's almost like they're suspiciously innocuous.
Yeah.
By the way, that's Bryce Neshcom Castillo. Hi. Running production, of course, joining us here in studio. All right, if you were going to guess what you're going to see at lemonparty.org, which is a site nobody should go to. Mm. What do you think you're going to see?
At Lemon Party.
Yeah. It's a lemon party. So festive. So citrusy.
Hang on. Let me just enter incognito mode.
Oh,
and we're ready.
I don't want to do this.
No. Well, here, Bonnie, just give us an idea. What do you think lemonparty.org is?
I have two thoughts. I think my first thought is it has lemons in some way interacting with genitalia.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Good. Hey, good guess. Because I think Tub Girl, last time you were very, very, very innocent with Tub Girl. You thought, you know, that it was going to be something very, very cutesy. So, all right, genitalia. And lemons. What's your second thought?
My second thought is like lemonade, but it's really pee-pee.
Pee-pee lemonade. Pee-pee lemonade or lemonade in genitalia.
You know what's so funny about this? And save the reveal here, Brian. Mm-hmm. You know, Bonnie's now trying to ward off. She's trying to nail it so it can be lesser when she sees it. And even then, it's just adorable. Just like, it's going to be lemonade, but pee-pee. Like, there's just an amazing innocence to it. What do you think Bonnie's reaction will be?
I don't want to risk guiding her.
Gotcha. Okay, yeah, that's a good point.
All right, so imagine if you're driving down and there's somebody, like, and this was an actual thing somebody did, was they had a big sign that said, politics leaving a sour taste in your mouth, or sour taste, lemonparty.org. And so people, you know, like, you know, assume my parents or whatever, like, oh, what's the lemon party? And when they went there,
all right, here, Bonnie, I want you to describe what you are looking at.
Okay.
All right.
Burn it into Oh, well, there's men enjoying each other. They're just having a nice time. There's three men.
You can be more graphic than that. Specifics.
There's three gray-haired gentlemen that
hold
are
on,
having
real quick. Carl Jung, are you still on the line? Can you describe to us what we're seeing?
Well, what I do in my private time isn't any of y'all's businesses, okay?
Here's the funny part. I think Lemon Party has kind of lost its standing as
now,
as
wait,
a shock
wait a
site.
I have a question to ask Bonnie.
I do too.
Show the Lemon Party again.
Okay.
Why is that? Where did the word lemon come from? It just went.
Just what it is.
Bye-bye.
Who of the three is having the most fun?
There is a correct answer.
There is a correct answer? Okay, Bryce.
I don't know where it went.
Oh, I
closed it. Otherwise,
oh God,
let me open another
pop
incognito.
Up during a meeting
lemon.
Someplace. I would think. I'm looking at it and I don't have my glasses on.
Oh, well, you need to get closer then. Just come on over.
That's okay.
Take a closer look there. All right.
It looks
right.
Like the man laying down in the middle is probably getting the best out of all the business. So
out of all the business.
Yeah, so apparently he did something very right.
Lemon Party is a gift. It's a reward.
You have done something very right to end up here at the Lemon Party.
Oh, my God. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much for that. Folks, you can go ahead and support this show at patreon.com/nightattack. Thank you, guys, everybody who have done it so far. We are on our our ride.
1776. Only 125 participants away.
Yeah. No, I mean, listen, again, just a penny. A penny, lemmy.
penny, a lemon. A pen and a lemon. A farty, a party.
a half dollar for your collar popped. Enjoy when you give that to us.
Hey, can we take a real quick moment? As long as we're talking some business early on, can we play? We got a new jam. We got a new jam from your man and mine down at the Lemon Party. I don't know.
Down at the docks. There's men with their socks.
We got another jam from Stephen Cogswell. What are we hearing here?
He updated the Hat Dance song from I don't know when this.
No,
was
let's get. There's a brand new one that has never been heard before. This was about our episode last week, wherein we were making sounds. Right. One of which was the queef from the Queen of England. It involved all manner of research.
It's a good biological lesson. Feel like it's nothing that we didn't learn in high school.
So here we go. This is the genius, Stephen Cogswell, with his Let's Talk About Queefs.
Hello.
Let's talk about queefs, baby.
Bonnie's already dancing.
Let's talk about queefs, Bonnie. Let's talk about them to me. Let's talk about all the air that comes out of your vagina when you lean. Let's talk about queefs. So let's talk about queefs, Bonnie.
Donald Trump, running of the bulls, acid trip, splorp, alley soup, Trump taking a dump, 1969 moon landing, old man chasing those damn kids, the sounds of my mother loving me.
No one's ever heard.
Queen Elizabeth, queefing.
What do you like here, Rob?
Let's talk about queefs.
But queefs are just like queefs.
Queefs.
Queefing.
Queefs.
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 Queef.
Queefing.
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 Queefs.
Queefing.
Queefing.
Q-U-E-E-F.
Queef eaters.
I'm gonna go out and touch my penis while you guys are talking.
Dude, no, that's metal as fuck, man.
Let's talk about queef.
You act like you've never heard a queef in your life.
Oh, we're doing a bit about queefing. What am I like, gonna do? Like,
I heard a queef or two in my time.
Your microphone like is off.
Do I get to divorce him now?
All right, I want everybody to go to awtfy.com/talk if you want to hear that. He also has a donation button there. If you enjoy the work of the genius Stephen Cogswell, then please support him. Man, there is so much of this show, from Spearmint Nitrate at the beginning to Stephen Cogswell, that is just like, we are so lucky to gather such amazing artisans to elevate our horse.
Dude, we're not going to claim like we're making the world a better place. And we're not even going to claim that we're making it better for all those moths we're attracting. But damned if we don't burn bright enough to attract a bunch of not moths who deeply regret getting too close to us and burn themselves. We're surrounded by the corpses of people who love us.
No, stop. I'm pulling the plug on your analogy. No. No. I mean, I'm complimenting people who put time and effort and hard work in their dedicated skills, and you're like, anyway, disposable insects, and we burnt them. Anyway. These are people who make a living at what they do.
Yeah, no, they're very talented.
And they do it for us for a passion, because we bring a spark.
Yes, and we betray them. They think we're the light of their life, and then instead we set fire to them, and they lie.
We don't set fire. We're warming them with our glow.
Oh, we're warming them, all right. We should be warning them against getting too close to the sun.
Are you trying to chase them away? Are you that self-destructive?
No, I'm just, it's that time of the moth again, man. What am I going
to
say?
That time of the moth. Oh, my God. If you like what you're hearing right now, head to Night Attack. Our Patreon, patreon.com/Night Attack. Man, take a look at that old lesbian in that Puerto Rican.
Oh, fuck you. Oh, damn it. Hey guys, that's the cursing belt.
Oh, the cursing belt now!
Oh, the accursed cursing belt. The belt of shame! That
the
means
witching
I have
hour
to...
whence the cursing belt comes round.
You guys suck.
All right, so by the way, if you have no idea...
Did you almost win the belt there, Bryce?
No.
If you have no idea what the belt is, or any reference that you hear, please go ahead to
DCTVpedia.com. All the inside jokes.
Pedia.com. All the inside jokes are there. We've had a couple of people ask, like, you know, what the hell anything is. So
they're like, I had somebody, they're like, yeah, I listened to your podcast. I'm like, which one? And we're like, it just sounded like horseshit. And I was like, oh, Night Attack. Yeah, no, that's great. That's great. I hope you enjoyed it.
That's what we were going for. So I'm glad it came through.
I had somebody else that was saying, oh, yeah, like, you know, crackers. That's all he said to me, like, crackers. Like, he was making fun of me for
not knowing what.
Not knowing the important parts of our history. I'm like,
Yeah, no, that's there was a meeting of business professionals, and there's somebody who, you know, in that casual way, you know, you see someone repeatedly and you offhandedly say, like, oh, I do a comedy podcast called Night Attack. And then at some point, like weeks later, I see him and he walks up and pauses, is just like, and he clears his throat and looks at me. He goes, freestyling, huh? And I was just like, oh, son of a bitch.
Wait, this was at South By. The South By story.
Yes, it was a South By story, but that we told on the air. But then all of a sudden, I realized that he watched like to me, like if you can make it through the gauntlet of Night Attack, then you're a special breed, and we're just destined to be best friends for life. Boy, let's take a quiz.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome somebody who has become a fast friend of this program. Again, a while ago, we decided we weren't going to have strangers on the show anymore because we're weird and we don't like people. But This man wormed his way so quickly into our hearts that now we're all co-signing on a house together. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome back to the program Mikey Neumann. Mikey, welcome.
Hello. How is everyone? Do we have it? We have nothing.
You're doing a hell of a ventriloquist.
There we go.
Hey, there you are. Mikey Neumann, how are you, sir?
There's a button. was I a moth?
No.
An analogy?
You're not supposed to know. You don't know you're a moth until you lay there with your wings singeing to the side.
Can we get away from the moth
staring
analogy?
Staring up at the bright, shining light of Justin and Brian.
The show called my Skype. And then you guys had this entire moth conversation, and I'm sitting here like just taking it, like okay.
No. We were talking.
You're officially walking back all moth-related language on this show. We are no longer going to be supporting moth updates. It is an abandoned. We are sunsetting the moth analogy.
It was a totally different story. We were talking about some moths.
That's cool. It's fine. I wrote you guys a quiz.
Oh, Mikey, yes. Mikey, we're so excited. By the way, do you have time to hang out with us through the rest of the show? Because we realize that when you come on, you, of course, have a dog in the fight for the upcoming movie draft update. You're going to hang around to talk smack, right?
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
I need Ninja Turtles to make a lot of money, and that's not a good position I think you want to be.
All right, so talk to us about the quiz.
Okay, so I forgot. Somebody from the show reached out to me. I forget their name. I'm sorry.
Mitsula. So yes. Real quick, let me just set up, because I think a lot of this happened in the after show. Mikey was on and made mention. I think it was the Chainsaw Suit podcast.
Yeah, I used to give Chris quizzes, and he gave me quizzes, and they're really dumb. So I pulled up some of the old ones.
There we go.
An example of one was Chris Brown tweet, or last words of a famous murderer. that is one of my favorite, because it's hard. It is so hard.
I do not doubt it. But well, you know, so, plus, so Mikey also made mention that, hey, I used to do dumb quizzes, and we were like, what? Dumb? Yeah. Like, hello, we want
so
in
that's
on
our
this game.
Brand.
Well, and plus, also, Justin is notoriously good at cutting through the crap on all these, but you were able to stump him. I even bowed out at one point during one of the quizzes, because it's like, I am clearly not qualified for this level of awesomeness, and so
I beat the over under on what was it, Nancy Grace?
Also the reality show pitch, whether or not they were real.
Your bookie reached out to me. I gave him the quiz topic so he could get you guys odds and overs and unders and everything.
Yeah, is he there in the chat right now? Hopefully,
he sent along tonight off.
That's why he needed.
Oh my god!
Jersey.
Yeah,
he sent along. Just.
Oh my god.
That's amazing.
By the way, what you are looking at right now, and for the audio listeners, this is Mitsula works with, I don't think we should even say the casino that he works at, but
at an actual sports book in Las Vegas.
Right.
And so this is listed up there on the sports book screen. Night Attack presents podcasts or not casts with Mikey. Right now, I am the over-under is 10.5, but I am a favorite, so you have to wager an extra $115 to bet. And meanwhile, that is both over and under. Brian, you are at 9.5 over and under.
So I like this. This isn't us competing with each other. We're just competing against the spread. We just want to outperform the spread,
correct,
right?
Correct.
Absolutely. So everybody go ahead and get your bets in right now in the chat realm. We'll be keeping track of all of them and paying out accordingly.
No, but yeah, and I'll be keeping track on the official scorecard. Justin, I rebranded your name because I wanted it to look like Steve Jobs, Ian Cool.
Oh, there you go. So, good.
Good. I liked it.
I feel like you need like that rebrand. And
I like the idea that you've trademarked my name too. That it's just like, hey, I just want to let you know.
Somebody has to.
Exactly.
Sorry, Kansas. Because I just sued Kansas for Just in the Wind. Where does that joke come from?
I don't know.
What? Crevice.
I turn around and you suddenly have three children to pull out that kind of dad joke.
Sorry, he's been storing
like,
them.
Sorry, Kansas.
All right. So this is, I guess, the category is podcast or not cast. Please explain.
I wrote down the titles of 15 podcasts with descriptions, different kinds of descriptions. Some I looked up reviews or pretended I did. So I wrote them all differently, and you're going to tell me if a podcast is real or fake.
Oh, I'm so excited. Okay.
These get pretty scary.
All right.
Are you ready?
Do you guys have pen and paper or a way to lock in your answer before?
Yeah, I guess
we just had him say it last time and switched.
Yeah.
The
Okay.
Yeah, I guess they aren't playing against each other, huh?
Yeah.
No, they're trying to beat the spread.
All right.
All right.
So I guess really my strategy should be just to say whatever Justin says.
Because sometimes you have to guess first. Justin, because he won last time, will guess first.
Okay. All right.
Guess first, second question.
Good call.
All right. Number one.
Mm-hmm.
Get cooking with Paula Deen. After a spat of job-losing, racially charged statements showcasing how little Paula Deen knows about anything, Paula Deen started a podcast.
All right, is that you?
I can change the wording in any way I want, as long as everything on the page is factual.
So this is not the official thing that is listed in iTunes.
The official one is actually more racist.
So. Gotcha. Okay. I do want. Can we please have brought up just the silent footage of Brian and Paula Deen? On the screen.
Oh.
I just want that up there so everybody can get a richer picture.
Do we have to? This kind of association was. Look at my smug, douchebag. Face here, look at me. Oh wait, no, you skipped it. Good, you skipped me. Look.
Oh God!
She's saying like, anyway, it's not like I'm gonna say something
Ryan,
terribly
your
racist.
Your hair looked like the Armageddon poster where the meteor crashes.
Yes, yes. It was going for Guile from Street Fighter 2, but I'm okay with this. That's the look of my brains exploding with the realization.
It looks like you defeated a chandelier in Mario, and now it's just upside down.
I realized this is uploaded on your own channel.
Of course it is. there's some damn fine fire eating coming up.
In fact, I'm shocked that after all that went down, you didn't change the title to Brian Bravely Deals with the Racist Politics. for better SEO. Okay, here we go. So
Ryan Brushwood. Get cooking with Paula Deen, real or fake?
I'm going to say fake.
So wait, it's just the title, right, that we're guessing on?
Well,
whether it's a real podcast.
Is what I described the real podcast.
Yeah. Like my guess is the description does not say, racist host, blah, blah, blah.
The implication with the factual statements listed there is that after going on a racist
after
type,
that,
she got
made
her fired from television, she started a podcast.
I believe no.
Called
that is fake.
Get Cooking with Paula Deen. You are both wrong.
Oh my God!
That's the easy one.
No! And by the way, the glee just radiating off of Mikey is palpable. This is amazing.
Okay, number one. The only reason why I went with fake was because I thought that she would have definitely had a podcast when she was popular, before she fell from grace.
No, well, and that's just it, is I figured if she was coming back after having lost the TV shows, this would have been like, we would have been reading on Reddit about 4chan kicking it around or posting stuff on it or something.
I'm surprised because she has her sons on the show. If you've ever seen them on her show, they were horrible. They had no personality. They're somehow actually worse on the podcast.
Can we listen to a sample?
No.
I also don't think we have that technology on the computer.
You know what? It's for the best. It's for the best.
That was not the first time someone has said no to that question about that podcast.
No.
Oh, honey, can we listen to it? No. No, we cannot. All right, number two. Justin, you're answering first on this one?
Number two.
Warp 5, a Star Trek Enterprise podcast. It's not an episode review show, but a deep dive on the topics and situations presented by the show. Features an episode entitled The First Rule of Cerillian Boat Club. X-Y-R-I-L-L-I-A-N. Is Warp 5 a Star Trek Enterprise podcast? That's the show, not the ship.
Yeah.
Is that a real podcast?
I will say no.
Yeah, I'm going to say no just because it's so believably vanilla that I question whether you would add it.
I'm going to say no because you spelled out a word, which was unnecessary theater craft.
Nope, it's real.
Damn it!
The reason I said it out loud is I wanted to spell it in case I was pronouncing it wrong, because someone in that chat room is going to be like, wow, found it quick. That's
Trek.fm. Trek.fm.
Yeah, they have a lot of Star Trek podcasts.
All right, fine, whatever.
Let's go. It looks in like it's looking like
table. Number three. Brian, you have to answer first on this one.
Roger.
The Gummy Authority. Think you know candy? You don't know shit. Trace Weeper, Greg Smith, and their dog named Truth give you weekly reviews of all the candy you're afraid to try. In our world, Haribo ain't shit.
I gotta think. I'm going to say yes. I'll say yes, because if it's not a show, it should be.
Huh. No's got to come in at some point. No.
Justin gets a point in his face.
Damn it. Yes.
You don't know shit, Brian, about candy or otherwise.
I lost the belt.
Getting so worked up about this game, Brian.
Now we know how to get him back.
Yeah. Hey, let's play a game. Let's arm wrestle.
Number four, this goes to Justin first, I think.
Yeah. Yep.
All right. Throw away your podcast. Steven Weber of Wings fame talks about a podcast he found every week and explains why those people should just pack it in and throw it away. Oh.
My God. Does Steven Weber possess the capability for such cruelty?
Just to correct the chat room real quick, Brian does not have one.
No, I have none. I have none. Brian has
an O.
Big old donut.
This is not real.
Okay.
It's fake.
I believe in magic. I believe in Santa Claus, and I want to live. You know what? I want to live in a world where this can be a real podcast, so I'm going to say it is a real one.
It's a fake one.
Damn.
Yes!
I apparently don't live in that world.
Magic's not real, you piece of shit.
You're a liar going around peddling your fake wares.
Sorry, Brian. I'm a little intense.
No.
Back on a roll.
Brian, you have to go first on this one.
Roger.
Number five. Mysterious matters for those who dare to think. Come along with Bob Bain as this podcast explores user-submitted stories of the supernatural. Other topics include proof that the neurosurgeon really did find heaven, 100 years of government cover-ups and conspiracies, splicing human DNA with alien DNA, have we already done it? How to talk to your child in the womb with pre-birth telepathic communication, does the human soul have control over its destination, and so many more.
The genius of your quiz is that there's no reason this shouldn't be real. I mean, you practically described the Weird Things podcast. I'll say it's real. Maybe it changed the guy's name or something.
This is real.
It is real.
Hey, who's on the board? You're on the board.
I did have to, like, look through their freaking episode guide to pull all that information out, and I kept being like, no, there's not a human that believes that, right? Telepathic pre-birth womb communication?
Oh, there is literally like no element of that that is unexplored on the internet. All of it is there. Every theory.
I mean, at some point, every supernatural program gets past their 40th episode and then starts to rethink, look at that pile that they passed over the first time.
There are, for those asking in the chat, there are 15 total questions, and we have done five. We are on to number six.
One.
You're on the board.
Yeah. All I have to do is get all the rest correct, and then I beat the spread.
Who's first on this one?
I totally Justin goes first on this one.
All right. Thank you. Number six.
Yeah.
Sabrina, the teenage Dharma and Greg fan. Episode by episode, Melissa Joan Hart recounts her favorite episodes of the Smash ABC hit. There were no guests that I could find, and iTunes user Flagmuffin points out, it gets a bit rambly at times, but Mel is so chill, worth a listen if you're bored.
Okay.
So the question is Mikey showboating now?
No, no.
Or is that?
here's what I do know.
Metagaming, baby.
Melissa Joan Hart has a lot of rabid interests. I know she has a rabid interest in professional wrestling and in Alabama football, but I do not think she has an interest in the others or the Dharma Initiative or anything else. I think that this
is lost.
I think
that's a different show.
Wait, what is this?
Dharma and Greg?
Dharma and Greg.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought, oh, shit.
Were you like, Dolph Dharma was on the show and there was a guy named Greg Gutenberg in that one episode.
Oh, wait,
so.
God damn it. Wait, this is about Dharma and Greg?
Yeah.
Oh, I guess they both were on ABC, though.
They were.
Yeah. I mean, no human would confuse Dharma and Greg for Lost, except for you, apparently.
Except for me.
Yeah, she was a fan of Dharma, which was on when she was on...
Nickelodeon.
Not Nickelodeon. She was on ABC.
Or, yeah, with the second one.
Just say it seems
Sabrina
like...
Sabrina
the Teenage Witch. All right. I'm going to say this is still fake. This is fake.
I'm gonna say you're exhibiting a bit too much knowledge of when and where Dharma and Greg was playing, so I'm gonna say it's fake.
It is fake.
Yay! It's all two, right. Justin. I got two.
Stuff it, Ferguson.
Number 7. Young Justice, food for vigilante thought. Thinking of donning a suit and patrolling the streets as a modern-day superhero? Get the inside scoop from the people who actually do it. Join Seattle's Red Justice and Chicago's The Youngest Avenger as they walk you through what it takes to be a real-life superhero.
Who has to go first?
Brian, I think.
Damn, this is unfortunate because I know Justin researched this topic for the G4 show that he worked on. And in fact, as you read those names, I saw your eyes dart around, Justin, like you're like, did I meet that guy? Do I know him?
No, I mean, make your pick.
I'll say it is real. Because I believe in magic.
I believe it's real, too.
Magic.
And the only thing that threw me off was that Seattle's real-life superhero is Phoenix Jones and not Red Wedding or whatever.
But that's why, I mean, look, if Seattle can give rise to...
Red Wedding? That's a bad superhero name.
he just shows up and dies instantly.
Exactly.
He keeps pulling his sleeve down to show you his chainmail just over and over.
No. It seems like, look, if you have a community where it's right for one person to be a costume vigilante, then that means you've got 100 people just itching to be.
I saw the first 15 minutes of The Dark Knight. I know how this works. There's copycats.
Right. So you were both wrong, and that's why I didn't list his actual name in there.
Damn!
Because I knew you would do that. You were like, well, that's not the guy, but... Because if I put his name, that would be dishonest. Well, if I put the real guy, then you'd be like, well, that's the real guy, and that's cheating. I had to make the people...
Wait, so every time you say a real name, we know it's real?
If I'm trying to manipulate, like if I listed two real superheroes.
See, Mike,
in their
Mikey's got
cities,
like 8 layers of mind screwery happening here. He's incepting us, going a layer deeper each time.
I incepted you was I wanted you to try to remember if that was the guy in Seattle, go, no, I'm pretty sure that wasn't him, and then guess it's real because of that. That's the level we're playing.
Okay. At. Number one, I would say that's totally a lie if it didn't actually work. Like, you know, so yeah. All right. Fine. Mastermind. Let's go. What's the next question?
I have a lot of. Number 8.
Yeah.
Going to Justin first here. Number 8. Love and Justice, a serious Sailor Moon podcast. Covering only the show Sailor Moon Crystal, this in-depth analysis of all things moon is currently celebrating its 123rd episode. In this episode, the gang takes an in-depth look at Act 32 of the manga and how it translated to the screen in Episode 33 of the show. Sorry, manga.
I believe this is real.
Yeah, I believe it's real, and I believe we may actually know the host.
Oh, shit. it is real.
Do we know the host?
No, I'm just saying. Given the fact that Patrick Delahanty hosts anime cons and all that stuff, we got people who are deep into this community.
No, yeah. What made me think it was real was that it made sense with the reboot, with like the episode number was consistent with the reboot.
I was surprised at 132 episodes, though.
Again, if there's one person who puts on a costume, there's a million people putting costume. You make one episode comparing the Sailor Moon manga to the actual television show, you're making 132 of them.
All right. The score is 5-3. Justin's up 5-3.
Let's go.
We're on number 9, Mr. Brushwood.
Yes, sir.
The Surly Goat Farmer. Hang on. That one sounds pretty weird, but hang on.
Oh, you don't say.
Go inside the world of the Renaissance Fair with the people that actually work there. This weekly podcast features tales from real workers all across the nation, from the pretzel pushers to the insult professionals at the dunk tank. Grab a flag and a mead and take a seat. Podcast features over 900 episodes.
Totally real.
That sigh of indignation.
Yeah, it's real.
It is fake.
No!
Yeah! Oh, you fell for the goat farmer.
Oh! Hot dog.
God damn it. That was so good.
Yeah.
People are freaking out.
Yeah.
What?
Life isn't worth living.
Renaming the show right now.
Someone will have started this podcast on iTunes by the end of this broadcast.
Oh.
It's real now.
There is a podcast called The Goat Farm, but that's about DevOps in the enterprise.
I said Surly
but
Goat
Farm.
Yeah,
Farmer. Surly Goat Farm.
Yeah. Damn.
Number 10, going back to Mr. Young.
All right.
Vegetarian Food for Thought by Compassionate Cooks. In each episode, chef and writer Colleen Patrick Gordeau.
Time out, Justin. He does this. It's that moment. That's when I feel like all this is some. I mean, he's just strutting
around. You know
what's
really funny? I write it, and then I, one, rewrite it from memory, or two, mistranslate it and shorten things so that it trips me up for real when I'm reading
And then there's this layer where he offers, you know, the next thing is he says, that's why I need your money right now.
Yeah. Oh, I would be
this
an amazing...
This is all a long con. This is all getting on. He's going to befriend us for 3 years. And then, you know, on the big anniversary episode of his first quiz appearance, he's going to be like, and this question, you'll need to put up $10,000.
But don't worry. It's just to prove you have it.
I was just going to value up your show with the quizzes and then sign the deal with ABC for the quiz show.
You're like,
listen, I got Melissa Joan Hart online too. I can make this Dharma and Greg.
Oh, MJ's on the phone? MJ, okay. Tell her to call her back.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt. Keep going,
Mikey. No, it's fine. Number 10. Vegetarian Food for Thought by Compassionate Cooks. In each ep, chef and writer Colleen Patrick Gordeau answers commonly asked questions about animal rights, food and nutrition, and the myths that surround them. Also the creators of the Compassion Immersion Retreat where for $195, you can commune with farm livestock and listen to seminars by popular vegan spokespeople like Tim Anderson, creator of Neighbors Opposed to Backyard Slaughter, a group focused on lobbying to legislate animal products.
I don't even know that it helps that you cracked up reading it, because that seems like something you seem like the kind of person that would crack up in his own writing.
I'm the kind of person you sit across from at the poker table and you're like, I got him. It's so obvious. And then like an hour later, you're like, oh, shit. Oh, no.
Yeah.
Character actor or a totally empty vessel. And either way, it's just.
I'm shooting to be Brad Dourif someday. Someday I'll be the
all
new
right.
Dourif.
This is real.
Hashtag the new Dariff, if you want to talk about it on Twitter.
No. So we got two hashtags we want to trend. Thumbs up Carl Jung and hashtag the new Dariff.
I'm going to deviate, Justin. You said you think it's real?
It's real.
I'm going to say it's too banal for Mikey to write. It's
too droll.
Well, droll means... That's precious great. And funny.
You're wrong. It is real.
Damn!
Yeah! Nothing is too bizarre in that space. I would just...
I liked that it just kept... when I got to the Compassion Immersion Retreat, because the podcast is basically an ad for her camp.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And then this guy who created Neighbors Opposed to Backyard Slaughter, a group that ruins your barbecue.
Number one, my wife used to work for PETA. There is nothing too bizarre. Oh.
This is actually all a long con PETA sting operation.
Exactly. No. Hey, by the way, if you'd like to make a donation right now, then
go to patreon.com/nightattack.
/ PETA.
All right. Number 11.
All right. This is
Brian?
It's not too late for me to come back from behind and
You're down by, it's 6-3, and there's 5 more questions. So you got.
I'll win them all, and I'll push Justin off.
You better start getting them right.
Yeah, you got it.
All right, number 11. Near misses, MISSES. Colby Renee takes you on a journey through the loves from various stages of her life. From Jason in college all the way through Steve getting down on one knee and proposing in front of the Chateau Marmont, only to break it off the next morning over brunch. Find out what it takes to be near misses.
Yes, it's real. It's real. It's real. Fine.
Can I read the description again?
Colby Renee takes you on a journey through the loves from various stages of her life. From Jason in college all the way through Steve getting down on one knee and proposing in front of the Chateau Marmont, only to break it off the next morning over brunch. Find out what it takes to be a near misses.
It's fake.
It is fake.
Yeah. What was the tip off for you, Justin?
I should have spelled MISSUS when I was talking about it. Was a good start.
No.
I
bet on the fact that even storytelling people don't have that much story.
There's no story. She dated a guy and then a guy was like, let's get married. And then he dumped her the next day.
Yeah. No, I mean, there's like 2 episodes, right? But it would have to be if near misses was readers send in stories of the relationships gone awry, I would have totally went with it.
Usually when I do ones like that, I take the plot from a romantic comedy I know no one has ever seen and just use that because people are like, that sounds familiar. I think I read about that.
Yeah. Well done.
All right.
All right. So 7-3. Number 12. TED Talks for kids and families. For some of the brightest minds in the world, these talks will inspire and intrigue even the youngest listener. Onstage talks range from regular TED events to a litany of TEDx partner events from around the world.
If that's not real, it should be. Like, that's just a different feed for content they're already sitting on. I'm going to say that's either real or a business plan.
So I'm using this to pitch.
Yeah.
So, wait. Like, TEDx for families or TED for families is the name
of
the podcast?
It's TED for kids. It's TED
for kids.
TED Talks for kids and family. They're kid-related TED Talks.
That's real.
It is real.
Yeah.
So it's 4-8.
I mean, because like if it were just if TED were just the one conference, then that would be a little weird. But since like the TEDx, there's 9 TEDx events happening right now as we speak. That's true. Like there's just a lot of those.
All right. Number 13.
Lucky number 13.
Let's the go. Steve Austin Show Unleashed. It's all caps. Live from Hollywood, California.
Who's going first?
It's odd, so Brian?
I went first last time.
Then Justin. Yeah.
Okay, it's real.
Live, can I read it?
Yeah, I'll say it's real too. Whatever Justin says.
Correct, it's real.
Yay!
Yeah, eventually we'd get to one that I've actually subscribed to.
I like that it keeps saying like really creepy and sexy stuff. Steve Austin lets loose on the no-holds-barred explicit version of the program.
Well, thank
goodness. Steve gets down and dirty with Hollywood celebrities, past wrestling buddies.
No, keep going.
No, I'm good. I'm done. I'm done. He's going to kill me. He's going to drive to my house.
We're going to have you reading Slash Fix in 20 more minutes.
All right. All right. So it's five to... You need to get four on the next two, Brian.
Okay. I'm done. I can do this.
So Number 14. Two more now? Well, to Brian first, right?
Yeah.
Casanova Crew Podcast. This pickup artist centered podcast features... This pickup artist centered podcast discusses the latest scene news and gossip with guests like Brad P, Asian Playboy, Vince Kelvin, DJ Fuji, and many, many more. Site currently features a black and white photo with big red letters saying, "Is Casanova Crew dead?"
See, this is very difficult because Mikey, this seems like a blank canvas over which, like Mikey would come up with this one just so he could make up the pickup artist douchebag.
But did he make the nicknames boring on purpose?
I'm gonna... Is Casanova Crew dead?
Yeah.
R.I.P. Casanova Crew. I'm gonna say...
That eulogy that Asian Playboy gave at the Casanova Crew's funeral... Brings a tear to your eye.
I'm gonna go with Max Trollbot's assessment. Real as racism, yo.
I'm gonna go with Brian, man. I want to believe we live in this world. I think Asian Playboy is for real. He DJ for Steve.
Real. He's real.
Yay!
All right. By the way, hey Brian. He's Casanova.
Oh, hot damn, hot damn.
And then the rest of their site is just plain text.
Just plain text, HTML, straight out of 1997.
Can we get it? All right, somebody find out whether or not Casanova Crew's dead. I'm actually invested now.
Let's click here for status.
Come on, Jay the Ripper. You got to come back for your fans, yo.
Oh, it looks like Casanova Crew is dead.
Whoa, that's a hell of a...
This is a really long announcement.
No excuses. Go ahead, and then it starts the numbering
9 pages in.
Well, and the numbers are... It looks like advice.
He's going. Oh, I guess now he's Jay the Ripper.
Hold on. Go back. The PS is a special thanks to... Just pick any line and read... Any set of names.
Oh, David. Okay, I thought it was David Koechner. The odd
Farin, Lord of Allure, Sexual Chocolate, Hydro, the greatest pickup artist from the OC, my co-founders Carson TBK, San Diego Lemonade Keto 5000, Magic from Chicago. I'm out.
All right, we got more questions on that quiz.
All right, hold on. We have one. All right, we got to come back to this. Nesh, keep that up.
Okay.
I think we need to go back with a hip hop beat and just yell shout outs to all the big block of names he has at the end.
I mean,
is he really dead or did he just?
No,
this is the show.
The Casanova Crew. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I'd like to think they all got married and had kids, and then there's no more picking up artistry they're doing.
I like how people in the chat are like, did Mikey make a fake page? That's a lot of writing. That is a lot. That's a long way to go for a joke.
Mikey made
Although, to be fair, halfway through, it was just the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog. We probably wouldn't notice if it was just Lauren Ipsum.
Lauren Ipsum, yeah.
All right, well, here's what's at stake. This is my over-under. Mitzula, listen.
Ryan is totally blown.
Yeah, no, I'm in trouble. Mothzula has defeated me, and it's up to you.
You and the moths!
I don't know what you're talking about.
So here we go. This determines over or under. So everybody get your over or under in there now because it comes down to this.
Ah, damn. My corpse. You got to draw crazy hair on that. Ugh.
It really does look like an impact terminal from a...
I'm okay with that. There you go. That works. Now you're talking.
All right. Number of the last, 15. The Amish comic show. All episodes are between 30 seconds and 4 minutes long. This podcast features Amish comedian Raymond, has 69 total downloads over all episodes, and features episodes like Practice Not Using the F Word, Scan Your Own Groceries, Love a Song I Heard in Sling Blade, and City Folks Are Afraid of Me.
I don't care if it's really real or just fake real. I want to believe. I say real.
So if I'm dissecting the clue, the only thing that it would be weird is knowing exactly how many downloads, right? Because that doesn't show on iTunes, but I'm sure there's other places that show downloads.
Yeah. Most of the podcasts I found had web players that had the view counts. I'd say 12.
Okay. So here's, all right, this is why this is an amazing final question. Because
it's too specific in a lot of ways.
No. Because if the point is that this was never heard of and it's not popular, then there's no podcast too weird, right? Like there's like on the fringes of people who start a podcast and it gets listened to by only themselves and their family. There's infinite weirdness.
I think what's important to remember here is that if this is real, I am the one that discovered it. Because clearly no one has.
Well, but also...
And tonight, I mean, this guy's head's going to explode.
I mean, if you're Amish, my guess is you're not Googling Amish podcasts because you sort of limited your accessibility to your target demo.
No, but if you're on Rumspringer and you pick up stand-up comedy and you want to have a gimmick, Amish comedian is a pretty good gimmick.
Oh, no. It's great.
Love a song. I heard in Sling Blade. It's my favorite.
It sounds like a good bit, man. I'm excited to hear that bit.
Love a song I heard in Sling Blade.
All right.
Don't fall for it. This is all Mikey performance arts. This is all Mikey getting in your mind.
I'm turning.
This is all just Mikey mothin'.
I'm turning off my guidance. Enough with you. It's real.
It is real.
Yeah!
It's real. Yeah! He's ready, gotta love it. Did it. Champagne.
It's great. It's a great page. It looks like a Squarespace joint.
Oops. Oh, my God. I'm so excited.
You guys, get that Earl in the chat. URL. I said Earl.
No, I like Earl.
Earl's Raymond's friend.
AmishComic.net.
Here's the thing. I was trying to Google this. I couldn't find a podcast, but I did see these rants.
The podcast was called The Amish Comic Show.
Let me look that up.
And there really are 69 total downloads, unless I added a few. I don't know.
Yeah, most of them are me.
Unless there's like 30 and you're like, shoot.
Oh, apparently it's on Spreaker. Spreaker.com/user/AmishComic. He is... There.
I had to use it. The podcast is 30 seconds long sometimes. Like, that's a minute 41. That's a podcast.
So he's just posting his bits then, right?
Yeah.
They're horrible.
Are they? Have you listened to it?
Yes.
Like, come on. You don't find it and not play. Can we get a little taste?
Yeah,
just a little taste?
It's the most miserable time of the year.
A little fair use commentary here. So far, so good.
It's the most miserable time of the year.
Ever done. Pack it up. Play the lullaby. Let's go to the movie draft minutes.
Sorry, Raymond. Your 15 minutes came and went like a breath. Gone.
Hop diggity dog. You know what? Maybe it's not as bad as everybody.
Maybe we got the wrong part of it. Let's just go to the middle of the song.
Christmas music in malls before it's October. Took the kids to see Santa. He was drunk and fell over. It was the most miserable time of the year.
Okay, all right. Fade it down. We'll come back to it. But I kind of am upset by. Do you think he has a genuine speech impediment, or is that a bit he's doing?
the world
sounded like a bit in what I heard. Honestly,
talking like it's
a put on.
All right, so how about this?
I think he might not be Amish, and he's trying Amish as an angle.
In which case, he's getting up there wearing Amish blackface, and he's like, it's really offensive to the Amish.
He's wearing
churned
butterface.
That's a word you're supposed to use. Amish blackface.
Wait, what is that? Their word? The Amish?
You just tried to reclaim racism as a white thing. Like, no.
I mean,
it's not the same.
Hey, by the way,
Brian's trying to take the word back.
Right. I mean, that's no! I don't understand why more Southern racists don't say, like, well, I'm taking the word back. it's a fictional racist that I'm talking about.
It's the Amish comic. Go, more of the song.
I don't know which of us is in the most trouble in the chat right now.
Let's just, where's the song?
Bought cookies at Giant. I said I baked them clean like a genius.
That's drunk.
This is great. Can we just keep
all of the stuff? And I like all your stuff.
Anytime one of us wants to take back something we said, we just play this, and it's like the sun blocks out the moon.
So
it's
Brian,
amazing.
You demonstrate. Demonstrate saying something that you don't want out there and then covering it up.
You should unsubscribe at Patreon.
Terrible time of the year. Shoveled snow for 10 hours till I hurt my back. The snow.
Okay, so here's why the people complaining about the Ghostbusters being women are right. No, you can't leave me out to dry.
I'm so sorry.
That was the bit.
I'm so sorry, Mikey. I'm so sorry. Sunbud in the chat.
Pause everything.
Dude, Sunbud in the chat in all caps just shouts, "Welcome to the family, bitch!"
I just need to explain to the audio listeners what happened.
Oh my god.
So, Mikey says that, and then his face I can only describe as a trapeze artist who is reaching out to the next trapeze only to find it not there.
Only to find me and Justin sitting on it, grinning as we give double middle fingers as we fly back.
Oh my god.
Here's the worst part, and this is what made it even more delicious, is I was able to see
burnt like a moth.
I saw I was able to see Neshcom scrambling to hit play because he was doing some other stuff. So it wasn't even like he was intentionally leaving you high and dry. And I know he felt terrible about it. That was amazing.
I'm sorry. Oh my God. So funny. So funny. Well, I'll tell you what.
My career is over. All I have now is the show.
Oh.
Well, welcome. We're your family now.
Welcome to the Lemon Party.
You just got 1,100 downvotes. And they're like, how dare you say that about Ghostbusters?
Hey.
I'm actually really excited to see Ghostbusters.
I am too, actually. I read this whole article about how, like, is it pronounced Fague or Fag? Paul Fague.
I'd always heard.
Yeah, there's this whole article about how, like, no, guys, seriously, all of Paul Feig's trailers are terrible. Look at the trailer for Spy, and it was really good.
Spy had the worst trailer ever.
Yeah. Hey, shall we take a look at the Movie Draft Minute?
Sure.
Indeed.
Welcome to your Movie Draft Minute, presented by
Oh, dear.
Presented by IamKuhan.com for the week of May 23rd, 2016. I'm your host, Naim Siddiqui. I've taken over the show. Roberto's locked in a closet somewhere, and you're never going to see him again. This is my Movie Draft Minute. Here are the standings. Team Cord Killers is still in sixth place, still waiting for their first movie. Team We Have Concerns in fifth place with $27 million. Team Amtrak is in fourth place, with Neighbors 2 Sorority Rising bringing in $21.7 million this week, and the Angry Birds movie bringing in $38.1 million, bringing his total to $119.5 million. Team Chainsaw Suits in third place with $360 million. Team DTNS drops to second place with $394.1 million. And in first place with $418.7 million, it's Team Night Attack.
Yeah!
And that is your Movie Draft Minute for the week of May 23rd, 2016.
Oh, dude, what a treat. Getting Kuhan back from the dead? I just assume he discovered girls and left us in the dust.
I really enjoyed the use of the TNC surf. That old NES game. That
was Yeah.
Surf design. TNC Surf Design, I think, was the name of the game.
Damn.
It featured a surfing. Look at that.
That's right. I do remember that.
It's
I used to
that
wear
little monkey riding the skateboard, and then you had something else riding a.
Nash, can you flash your camera to me? My stuff went crazy. There we go. Man. All right. So we're up, Brian.
For the moment.
But not by much.
I don't know what we have left to catch you. I know I have Ninja Turtles.
Yeah. You've got Alice through the Looking Glass.
Oh, and Central Intelligence. We still have three. Mother's Day. Totally bombed.
Yeah. You sort of lost all your lead. You came out really strong with Dawn of Justice, and then everyone saw the movie. And then they stopped seeing
the
movie.
Well, it was a bad movie, and then people didn't want to see it again.
That's the problem. People like to go to movies, and then if it's terrible, they're like, I should stop seeing this movie.
true story. So I only just recently saw Batman, 3 days ago.
Mm-hmm.
I liked it.
Batman versus Superman?
Not like I liked Civil War, which was actually
sure. But you liked it for the expectations that you had going.
No, I liked it for really weird reasons. Like I liked it because it was this really hardcore, misguided and sort of insane look at Batman and Superman.
Yeah.
As murderers.
Yeah.
Because this is the world where Superman is already a killer, so it's already stupid. So let's bring in Batman, also already as a kid. Like it was just very odd. And so committed to making this crazy thing. I was like, well, I mean, we got other Superman movies. At least we got this crazy, silly one.
It does kind of feel very latter Frank Miller when, like, no one's going to tell Frank Miller no. And now he's just like, yeah, no, they're all killers. They murder. And you know, we're just going to casually toss in this thing that Batman's physically himself branding, like, sex criminals so they can then get murdered by other criminals. And he's, like, totally okay with this. And this is kind of the way that he, like, gets his rocks
off.
Well,
wait, didn't he go on to write, like, Batman murdering Al-Qaeda and then had to, they're like, no, you can't, seriously, not for the Batman property.
Frank Miller,
and then
the real Frank Miller, yes, no, wrote a Batman murders Al-Qaeda thing, and DC was like, yeah, about that. We'll publish it because we love money, but we're not going to let you have Batman. You have to make him like, you know,
the brown recluse or something.
Yeah,
holy terror. Holy terror, Batman. Wow. Right. So where are we at right now? We've got left in the tank. We have Secret Life of Pets and Ghostbusters. That's it. And that is up against DTNS's Free State of Jones, Now You See Me 2, Star Trek Beyond, and Suicide Squad. I mean, we could call it for DTNS, right?
What are they? They have Star Trek and Suicide Squad?
Yep.
And Now You See Me 2 could make a lot of... Free State of Jones, I don't think is going to matter.
No.
But that's a big...
Star Trek's going to make... Secret Life of Pets to be Despicable Me.
Yeah. It needs to be surprise, huge good. But is it close to Finding Dory? Is it in the same ballpark as far as time release schedule?
Dory is June 17. Secret Life of Pets is July 8. So about 2-3 weeks.
You now care that Ghostbusters is great.
Oh, dude, it's going to be amazing.
Because if it's great, it's going to go... Because all the attention's on it. Like, that's the story of the year. Oh, it's actually good?
Oh, my gosh, you're so right.
That's huge.
It's almost like the newspaper headlines are pre-written to be like, the most hated trailer of the year turns out to be absolutely hilarious.
Yeah, but look at the other most hated trailer. It was Call of Duty had one. Whatever. It's going to sell, like, 40 million copies. Like, it doesn't matter.
I mean, I guess that is the way to look at it as far as opening week box office, is that a lot of people know that this thing is coming out. Because now the reaction to it became its own story, right? Its own naturally growing story. Yeah, I don't know. I'm talking myself into it. We're hosed. Like,
the only thing so far that has had any damage is if I went to LA for a thing and I went to an editing house and they're like, oh, look at all our work. We did the Ghostbusters announcement trailer. I'd be like, okay, bye. Yeah, like that that is the that. Only person I don't want to work with right now.
We have to leave now.
Hey, yeah. Justin.
Yes, sir.
Did you hear about the little thing called the Podcast Awards? They announced their nominees.
Oh, that was why I did the podcast.
Oh, is it in honor of the Podcast Awards?
Yes.
Justin, did you hear that I hear a podcast that you're on or created or three or four are up for awards?
Absolutely. So thank you to everybody, of course, who was part of our Hatting the System.
It's not ours. It was an independent consortium of people who happen to like a bunch of
I meant
podcasts.
The royal R's. everything went according to plan, except for the things that totally didn't.
Yeah. If you go to hat.t2t2.eu, you could tell that this little political party, this gathering of podcast fans, they elected a slate and they all nominated them, and they all got nominated for the categories that they were hoping to be in, except for the Gizwiz. Sorry, Chad.
I'm not Gizwiz, on there. Oh. I see how it is.
Before we became beef FFs.
I think it's because the TV crimes, I need more than 9 episodes. I need to like hammer Will down for some time. Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what. I think everything according to all the nominations kind of went okay. We will have the slate system, politics, 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 and jury got nominated for government and mature respectively, which means that we have a chance to keep this award in-house. We can go 2015, 2016, winning the mature podcast. Thank you to everybody who helped nominate it. Yeah. And I believe that we will bring home literally everything that we have put on that slate. So keep an eye on out for that. We'll, of course, plug it everything and every place that we can. And T2T2 was talking to me, and I think that he's got a couple really fun ideas on reasons why people should be coming back to that website every day.
Yeah, man. Daily voting opens May 29th. We're sure T2T2 has some awesome way to remind you to vote every day. Also, Scam School, Cord Killers, and Weird Things got nominated. We're
and
very, very excited.
The Bizarre Briefing.
And the Bizarre Briefing. That's right. Recorded right here in the
Me,
studio.
John, and Brant's show.
That's right.
Oh, yeah. All right. So let's go ahead on into Diamond Time. Diamond Time is where you can shout out your own project right here on the show. Just go on over to our Reddit, reddit.com/r/diamondclub or diamondclub.reddit.com. Our first one this week is from the Nerdologist. Hi, chat realm. Me and a couple of friends just started a new video game podcast called Couch Kings that sometimes also dabbles in movies. We do video game reviews, cover current news, feature a retro game each week, and play fun gaming-related games on screen. We'd really appreciate you guys checking out our podcast and hopefully subscribing to our channel. Thanks, everyone. The YouTube channel is yolo420.com/couchkings or couchkingspodcast.wordpress.com.
Matthew DPX writes, I don't know if we've decided who we're voting for in the arts category of the podcast awards this year or not, but if we haven't picked anyone, I'd strongly suggest we vote for my friend Sarah's podcast, the Right Now Podcast, WRITE. She's already made the cut of nominees. Sarah's incredibly passionate about the craft of writing. I think she deserves our love and support. You can listen to her show at at yolo420.com/writeswag, WRITE. Also,
I kind of have the beerus.
Well, if you, whoever you are, want to defect from the hat party, then
still a great night. And of course, Noisemaker Joe writes, well, since you wonderful people have managed to get Joe and Meg's musical adventure on the slate for the podcast awards, why not listen to it? Joe and Meg's musical adventure is a show where I show my best friend music and delight in her enjoying it, or try to convince her to at least understand it. It's the highlight of my week to do the show, and I'm so appreciative that y'all have gotten it in a much more visible place. Find it at jamashow.com. That is JAMMAshow.com. And maybe leave us a 5-star review on iTunes. Don't push it.
Hey, Mikey, what are you up to these days?
I am working on a new episode of Movies of Mikey.
Is this the one you teased recently?
Yeah, it's Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Well, the website's not updated. Oh, shit. I haven't put up Fury Road or Star Wars, and Star Wars was the biggest episode ever by far.
So can we get a touch of a spoiler? Because I know that most of your reviews are loving tributes to the positive sides of things. I rather liked the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy movie, and there are some people who didn't like it, and those people are big fat meanie faces.
Yeah, I definitely like it a lot, but I think the sort of film theory to this episode, unlike the Scott Pilgrim episode where I made a clear delineation between source material and film.
Yeah.
This one, I'm more talking to the, because we do this thing a lot where with adaptations and reboots and things, we compare and pick a winner. We're like, this one's better than this. You know, it's like new Ghostbusters sucks. Old Ghostbusters is good. It doesn't cheapen the old one to like more than one. And it's sort of a lie that you have to pick a better one. Like you talk about,
No, I mean, it's like that Game old Thrones, quote.
Right? Like, well, the book people are pissed now. It's like, it's all fine. Just read the books and watch the show in whatever order makes you happy.
It's like that. It's like that old saying, a candle loses none of its light by burning a moth.
Garbage. You're just a...
No, I'm sorry.
That old saying. Put it on a tea towel.
Well done.
So, all right. So here, I mean, now, because now it's like a personal insult to Mikey. You're just like, what? You're just picking that.
No, I mean, it's first of all, it's not an insult. It's a loving tribute. And we're speaking to all of Chat Realm because actually, Mikey, you came in. God, now I feel the need to actually smooth things over. You bastard.
I'm fine. I didn't even catch what the insult was.
You almost got me, Justin. You almost got me cursing. No, I was actually talking about the talented people who do stuff like...
No, you know, there's no explaining. Listen, why don't you moth your ass on out of here? So here's the thing. Movies with Mikey, if you have not seen it, you need to see it. I think so. These last, you're on a bit of a roll, right? Because you had Fury Road, which was very well picked up and discussed, and Force Awakens was more double plus, right?
Yeah, that was huge because I did Ex Machina in the middle there, which did pretty much to the box office what the movie did, which was not a lot. But I had said, because I do the voting. And as to be a jerk on the end of the Big Trouble in Little China episode, I think I made the vote. You must choose Fury Road, Ex Machina, or Star Wars, which exploded.
Yeah.
And I made an announcement that I was going to do all three. And then I let them vote again each episode. And they actually like agreed in the comments to like vote for Star Wars last because they wanted to save it.
Gotcha.
It was really interesting.
That's red.
So you do something in the comment section on YouTube that seems impossible. You've curated a team of thoughtful people who have dialogue with respect, and we were talking about that over Twitter the other day.
Until Star Wars kind of opened the can pretty wide. They get in fights, and I was gonna sort of put the stop to it, but. This guy would just come in and like one dude just started replying to everyone that liked the video. Cause like the video moved a lot of people, I think.
Oh dude.
Emotionally.
No, there is something wonderful and precious about the poetry that you wrote at the end of that review. I mean, it's like I found myself, you know, kind of heart soaring. And of course, maybe it didn't help that I watched it at 2 a.m. when you released it that day. But it was great.
Yeah, I felt it when I was doing it because it sort of happened organically where I just wanted to talk about why Star Wars has meaning and why people care. So it kind of cuts in front of the troll because the trolls did come in and they're like, it's just New Hope again. Because the review starts with everything they're going to list in the comments.
Yes.
And they still listed it. And I was like, everyone's just going to disagree. Like the point of this was to have a discussion. People have some firm points, but I'm simply saying that the amount of joy that Star Wars puts out into the world, especially as a result of The Force Awakens and all the new people now getting joy out of it, it's not really on anyone to take that away.
Well, and I thought what was great, and everybody needs to watch it because you explained it in a far more poetic fashion than I will, but and this is something that amongst the very well-trodden area of Star Trek criticism, I had not really heard spelled out in the way that you did, which is part of why the prequels might not have resonated and The Force Awakens as well as the original trilogy did was this idea that the prequels was all about punishing characters for their love and connections, and that The Force Awakens starts in this kind of fallow land that then begins to grow connections and characters.
Exactly. And it needs you to feel like you came off of the abusive relationship that the prequels were for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And that's why, one, I point out that specifically there are no romantic connections in The Force Awakens whatsoever. Yeah. Everyone is broken up, including the droids. R2-D2 just turned off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you have all this going around and a lot of people needing hope, which is what A New Hope was about, but we have a better understanding of it now. And that one line I put in there about the quote-unquote disturbing assertion that the prequels make is that Darth Vader exists because of love.
Yeah.
Which is so effed up. Like, that's not okay. And I was sort of taking that back, I think, for The Force Awakens and J.J., and I think what they're trying to do.
And especially loved your commentary on the strangeness of, like, how extraordinary it is that, that, you know, we're for the first time hearing about somebody being seduced by the light side of the Force, you know, that...
Which they say verbatim in the movie.
Yeah, I hear the call of the light or whatever, yeah.
Yeah, and he's like, you will not be seduced. I'm like, they use the word seduced in it, so it's very clear that they're doing something different. Though I hate to use this because the red letter media is like pushed it down our throats as like a really bad thing, and it was, but it does kind of rhyme with A New Hope.
Yes, yeah.
Like, unavoidably, yeah, no. And I'm like, you at least took what he was going for and tried to interpret it in your own way.
Well, and I think that like what you do a very good job in, and I found myself thinking a lot about this with Civil War, and both of them are kind of had the similar challenges. Star Wars far greater, that like JJ first had to not screw it up, right?
Right.
Like he had to carry a lot of stuff and then just not blow it up and not end this thing, because we were on such fickle ground with our relationship with Star Wars going into the Force Awakens.
He also had to blow a bunch of dog whistles. That almost came out really bad. He had to sound a bunch of dog whistles, like little things like using film and not digital, to, you know, all of these things, practical effects and not digital effects, all of which is to say, hey, we all remember what Star Wars was. We're going back to it. Yes.
By the way, Brian, God damn it. Now literally everybody in the chat room is seduced to the light like the moth to a flame. Many Mothins died for this information.
Blow a bunch of dog whistles.
I hated Moth Doll in the prequels. God damn it. Mikey, of course, Movies with Mikey, a new TV crimes podcast coming soon, hopefully.
Yeah, I've been talking to Will because he was busy with tabletop shooting. We've been texting, trying to set a time, so very soon.
Hey, one last thing before we wrap everything up. Have you gotten that vibe in your life? Because last time we had both received it, but Justin didn't have it set up. So we're 1 week into living in the future now.
I don't have one. Have
you experienced
Oculus.
It?
I have an Oculus developer kit.
Mm.
I can't see in stereoscopic 3D, so it's not quite as futury for me.
Wait, you know, Bonnie is blind in one eye. She can't have stereo vision either. And my roommate in college had a glass eye, and I remember he had the best reversal. I was like, oh man, you can't experience 3D games. And he goes, psh, it's all 3D to me. And I was just like, oh, damn. I just got served.
Yeah, a little bit. Makes driving hard.
Yeah.
Cool beans. Well, all right. At Mikey Face on Twitter.
Did you just
Yeah, cool at beans? Mikey Face on Twitter, yeah. That's me.
Mikey Neumann, you're a god dang national treasure. Thank you so very, very much for joining us. We can't wait to see you again. And until then, we'll all check out the next movie with Mikey and all of your awesome, awesome stuff.
Cool.
Brian, what do you got cooking?
A little bit of Jack and or S word. You're not going to get me to swear in the end. A bunch of stuff going on. We're actually shooting a top secret project for the next 3 days. That'll be something I'm hopefully going to be real proud of next month and be able to talk about.
Okay. And of course, everybody follow Ashwood on Twitter. Stickers are DIAF, man. If you want to get stickers in your life, $5 packs. Go ahead and get them, stickers or DIAF. Man, we've had a hell of a reaction. I am so excited that everybody has been super pumped about this. It has been a real fun little exercise in like small scale entrepreneurship. Like getting paid for something other than yelling into a microphone has been really excited. So yeah, check it out, stickers or DIAF.
Man, it's been a hell of an evening. We learned a lot. We learned that Brian should stop making metaphors.
We learned that Brian or that Justin continues to kick your ass.
Oh yeah, no. That's like learning that gravity still works.
That's like learning that gravity's wet. No, I mixed that one up.
That's like being surprised that a moth flies crooked.
Stop with the moth thing. No more moths.
See you next Tuesday.
Die to fire, people.
I wanna hurt myself by pissing off some bees. I'm allergic to bees. Oh, Justin Robert Young, every time you go, I get so sad that I wanna drink a warm glass of Drano. Night attack, 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 night attack. I love you.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.